supporting businesses that also look at the second or third bottom lines. Is that not the difference?
Well, maybe what we could say is that doing businesses which don't serve such segments was at that point for India also in some sense a social business, because it was in, underserved in those ways. I mean, you're talking about basic infrastructure, you're talking about, you know, several other businesses which have become successful. But as the country has evolved and where we are today, I think that the bottom of the pyramid market is an attractive market in itself as well. So if I was to put on my philanthropist headset and say we must do good for society, that's fine. But I'm also saying that there is an opportunity here which is good business. So we don't need to necessarily wear our do-gooder jacket to justify being there. And if we can do that, probably we will have a more sustainable story to tell. And that is really actually more a question, I'm saying, than a statement, to say that, you know, is it really necessary to only go to the bottom of the pyramid to serve that segment only if you want to do good? And yes, there have been models even in recent times which have miserably failed because probably greed took over and those models have collapsed. But I say that if we don't, and that in a loose way I would like to say is a Western mindset we've imposed on our Indian being, that, you know, the only thing that would matter is return. But it's also wrong to say that return doesn't matter. So in that sense, I'm saying that if we look at the bottom of the pyramid customer, you're looking at a customer who wants a superior product at the best price in the most efficient way. You're talking about a tough business environment. And then you want to put on top of that that layer of saying, but no, it must not, you know, look at profit. Profit is not a bad word. It's the only way they will grow, the only way they will scale, the only way they will really reach and penetrate that market. So I'm more concerned about constantly putting it into this backroom placing, you know, this is underserved, it is poor people, this is...
Can I add something? Just to add, and this difference between social and entrepreneur, it just struck me while you were saying, see, I come from a place called Coimbatore, which is in Tamil Nadu. And let me just give you an example. The industrial community in Coimbatore is so advanced in that sense. It's a place where I can tell you, sugar factories, textile mills, automobile parts, schools, all of them have been done by the vibrant industrial community in Coimbatore. Yeah, sugar factory, in the one where they deal with about 20,000 farmers. They supply clean power. They have a cogeneration. These are classic examples that we cite today of impact investment, that it's clean power, working with thousands and hundreds of farmers, making products, manure. They spin yarn and sell cotton. They have Apache cotton. They get organic cotton. They spin it. They are classic organic businesses. And yet, if you ask them, they are all family-run businesses. I think family businesses in India are, I would think, at least 60% of the GDP of all, 60-70%. See, family-run businesses have been there for so long, and the very reason they got into a business was, because, of course, they wanted to make money, but if you look at examples of these, who would debate that they are not impact investments? All of them are impact investments. And all these people are among the richest in Coimbatore as well, or maybe in the whole of India, maybe one of them, some of them are very rich people. I think at the creating a difference between what is social and non-social, at least in their minds, I don't think was there. I mean, they were just doing this because they believe this is a great opportunity. There is no sugar factory there. There is no textile mill there. So let's do it. And they believed it's also a way of making money. I think the one step further from there is, while they were family business, they are able to put in their heart, sweat, energy, et cetera, et cetera. I think what we are coming to is, can there be a third party institutional mechanism that can then validate such businesses outside and therefore play the role of convincing an investor to say that what this third party is doing is exactly what the investor wants to do? I think that level of intermediation from somebody else to then go on and putting money there might need some levels, because the person who's giving the money himself is not involved into it. He himself may not be aware of the opportunity, et cetera, et cetera. I think that is where the challenge of creating successful people who have come out of the system and really made an impact in terms of really scaling up businesses, made a money role model, which I think I was thinking from that perspective.
So Rohini, if I could add something to that, I mean, you must realize we're not talking about charity or philanthropy, we're talking about investing.
Yep.
And investing comes with it a need for returns. And if you look at the basic fund structures, very large funds, for example, venture funds or PE funds, only need to return 2x. The small ones need to return 3, 3.5x, you know, to make sense to everybody else. So you must really understand that the smaller the fund, and the smaller the fund, the small funds are the ones likely to invest in what you might call social enterprises, have a need for a higher, sometimes, you know, 500 basis points, 700 basis points higher IRR than a large fund. So it's even more difficult to expect charitable, quote-unquote, second bottom line, third bottom line, fourth bottom line thinking from us. The first bottom line is important. The challenge at our end is always very obvious. It is, how am I going to exit this enterprise? So I can give it a million, 2 million, 5 million, but at the end of it, can it go IPO? If not, is somebody going to buy it? If I can't go IPO, if nobody's going to buy it, I can't even touch that business, right? So the challenges are very much, how do we exit that business? A large business is, you know, yeah, you get 100 crores in revenues, 500 crores in revenues, depending on the sector, you can IPO. How do I IPO a company, you know, which has 10 crores in top line? It's extraordinarily difficult, right? So our need for returns and need for IR is actually significantly higher than that of other funds. And hence, our expectations are far more extreme and severe of the sector. We have, for example, in the last couple of years, it's become very, let's say, fashionable for a lot of, you know, overseas Indians to come back to India to set up an enterprise in India. So we met quite a few of them. We see expectations, so we go through the CK Prahlad bottom of the pyramid story, and we see the business plan that we are serving these guys who have incomes of a dollar a day or less, except the promoters want to take $100,000 salaries, right? So it just doesn't make it, it doesn't work that way. You must really understand that this has to work to these norms. Yes, you've probably come from Harvard or MIT, that's perfectly fine, and you've kind of given up those salaries, but that doesn't, you know, we're not concerned about that. This has to be a business that makes sense on its own bottom line. It has to be exitable. Only then can we pour more money back into the system. So I just wanted to add
that. Right, so then is that what's missing, that understanding of that kind of investor? Either of you could answer that. Is there a category of investor that is missing between the philanthropist and the guy who's 10 times removed from the business and who wants a phenomenal rate of return within a few days?
See,
is there something in between? And is that the crux of it?
It is. It is that, and I think what you earlier said, that, you know, commercial enterprises may not have served the social needs of the society. So we have this new creature that we are creating, which is called social enterprise. I mean, if you see historically, NGOs are there because the government has failed in some areas, and NGOs come and, you know, hopefully plug that gap in their own way. In the same way, we are assuming that commercial businesses, the ones which are for returns and earning $100,000 salaries and all that, are by its very, you know, the pursuit of returns and scale are hence either amoral or, you know, asocial. And hence we need something called social enterprises, which makes a good trade-off between extreme pursuit of returns versus social enterprises. I think in the last 8-10 years, even that hypothesis is being questioned, because I think even a company that creates jobs, I mean, instead of making returns, but create jobs and provides, you know, goods and services, is itself not asocial or amoral. So I think all businesses at the end of the day, especially early stage businesses, because they do cater to some new emerging needs and segments, they are obviously a lot more automatically pro-social, whether they're commercial or not. So I think given that, this distinction is increasingly becoming a lot more complex to understand. The second problem we have is you also now want to create these social enterprises, but you also want third-party investors into that. Mm-hmm. Now, if I ran my own business and I want to make it a social enterprise, saying I won't make, you know, my returns beyond 11-12% as long as I can serve the needs of the society, all the small, you know, family-owned businesses. I think Amul is another classic case. Amul did not have to go out to raise, you know, capital from outside. So you also need alternative ownership structures. And as long as we keep on asking third-party investors who have the needs that, you know, have been spoken about, scale and returns and all of that, it again breaks down. It's already a complex, you know, business to execute between social and commercial. And now you want third-party investors who may not really have the attention span and the capability to make that trade-off. And I think the third one we have problem is, and I have interacted with a few, is social enterprises who are for commercial objectives also have this need to be social when it is good to be social and commercial when it needs to be commercial. And it adds to the confusion in that. Because I think, you know, whether you're going for a bank loan or you're going to investors, just because you are doing something social, it's very hard to, you know, say that I'm doing social, so give me interest rate which is slightly lower or give me capital in a much easier way. Instead of struggling for 18 months, I should get it in 8 months. I think it's very hard for, it could be, I mean, they're asking for that is not wrong, but it's hard for investors to give that, or even the guys who give you credit to give that.
Right. You were talking about some survey, but I heard of another survey which J.P. Morgan did, which says $1 trillion will come into this sector, and you could almost see the money behind that. Now, we've seen what happened in the microfinance sector. Now, do you, the point he was making, if you begin to see this as a sector where you are going to make those kinds of profits, and what will happen then? If we are saying missing impact investor, is it a good thing that he's the very, that there's not a drove of investors waiting outside the door to say we want to make money from this sector? Is that a good thing or a bad thing, in fact?
Well, it's a good question. The jury's out on that, actually. You know, the idea is the market is maturing. As Mahesh said, we have mandates. Our mandate is make money, 3x, 4x returns, because we're doing mostly technology investments. We have LPs who have a mandate. The market's so mature that immature, you know, angel investing, the business that I've been in the last 11 years, in the US is a $20 billion industry, and Europe is about the same. That means in the US about 50,000 deals happen on a yearly basis, angel investors across the United States putting this capital. Till 2008, it was $26 billion. It was bigger than the VC industry in the United States, which is an old industry. Now, in India, there's 100 angel deals a year, at least officially calculated. So can you imagine the difference, the delta between what is an oops. Yeah, can you imagine the delta between what is happening? So our industry, our country is just getting there. We've just started. We started this group, Mumbai Angels, in 2006. And when I started it, I went to the web to look for one, to join one. And I was amazed that none existed. Not one. How can that be possible? In 2006. And we have 120 members, and we have 100 members waiting. But that's not enough. There's now Indian Angel Networks, the Chennai Angels coming up. That's still not enough. Every city needs 4 or 5 angel groups. That's only for the commercial business. Then you start getting people who say, okay, hold on, we have a social angle to this whole thing. So my point being that we're getting there. That's why I said version 1, version 2 is on its way. There are professional investors. They're sitting on this panel. They're sitting in this audience that are doing all the hard work of getting there, understanding what the realities are. In the West, you have philanthropists who started giving back. Now, at the end of the day, $3, 4, 5 billion looks like a lot of money, but actually it's not a lot of money, ladies and gentlemen. If I am the founder of eBay, Pierre Omidyar, and I want to give, you know, $1 billion of mine, that'll be gone like this. So unless there's a payback to what he's giving, how do you expect it to be it's not a running tap. Bill Gates has already spent $1 billion in TB, and then you realize he made a mistake. It's gone. But he has $50 billion. So it sounds like it's a lot of money. It's not. So unless there's payback, there has to be a mechanism. So they're saying, okay, can this be commercial as well? The commercial angle is more to just keep it going. The commercial investor will probably expect a lower return, but they expect return. I think that's what people have to understand. That's why people here are saying that, look,